So Galileo is a professor at the University of Padua, and he's actually making at the time 3 times his salary off of sale of, but teaching with, how to use this instrument to calculate cube roots, compound interest, basically anything that's functioning in proportion you can calculate easily with this instrument. So he has the instrument itself, and you can buy the instrument. He sells some of these. There's, you know, some record that he sold maybe 100 of them, or made and sold about 100. But the real money maker is that people are paying to learn from him and to potentially live in his house while he's learning, while they're learning, taking these lessons from him. So Galileo actually ends up publishing a book on how to use this, but the manual, the book, the printed manual of the book, you can't really figure it all out from it. You can't, you need the instrument and the book and the lessons all together. So this becomes an opportunity to reflect on how Galileo uses and manages his own fame, his own expertise, what we think of as his scientific expertise and reputation in a period before he gets famous for the telescope. So if you want to come up close for a second, you see where the plumb line, the string is hanging, and then up in the center of it there, that's the coat of arms of the Gonzaga Duke of Mantua. And so Galileo's using this instrument to try to make a move to a more prestigious position. He's giving this particular instrument to a duke with the hope of using it to leverage to a more prestigious position. This is exactly the move that he ends up doing also with the telescope.
In the 1930s, early 1930s, when the university constructed the Lyman Laboratory for Physics, there was a concern, especially by J. Curry Street, who was a physicist studying atomic particles that are being bombarded constantly on Earth, that the new slate roof on the new laboratory would be too thick and would inhibit the cosmic particles that he wanted to study. So just outside Lyman Lab, he had installed a shed that he called the Cosmic Ray Shed, with a simple tar roof made of wood, where he could install cloud chambers, which are devices that use a container of alcohol, so that when cosmic rays come down out of the sky, they displace electrons in the alcohol and show the electron spread over time on an electrical, on a metal plate. And so from that space, J. Curry Street, he was among the first to observe the muon, which is a particle that is very similar to the electron, describe its energy. And he was able to work with others in the shed to first see and describe nuclear magnetic resonance, which resulted in several Nobel Prizes for its discoverers. And the shed remained outside of the Lyman Lab for more than, it was 70 years. It was used as a little bit of a laboratory. It was a meeting space for physicists to come into the space where so much had been discovered, before it was eventually torn down. And we saved this ventilation shaft because we couldn't keep the whole shed, but it's a really important part of the legacy of physics here at Harvard University.
So this is a Polaroid 20 by 24 camera that was given to the collection of historical scientific instruments by Edwin Land, the founder of Polaroid. This is one of 7 20 by 24 cameras that were built between 1976 and the mid 1980s. The camera was originally, the purpose of the camera system was to highlight a new type of film developed by Polaroid. It was a marketing idea, and it developed a life of its own. And several famous photographers like Elsa Dorfman, who worked here in Cambridge, Dawood Bey, the Harvard Art Museums has a collection of 20 by 24 photos taken by Dawood Bey, have used this camera. Andy Warhol used this camera system. There's a portrait of Bill Clinton taken with this camera system. Inspired many photographers, because ultra large format photography, which would be the category of photography that this camera is involved in, inspires people in a way like no other type of photography, because the extremely large film plan produces images with very shallow depth of field and a unique image quality that can't be duplicated in any other way. So people would pose in front of the lens, and the photographer would be back here under a hood. And on this ground glass, it's called, this is actually a Fresnel lens, but it's referred to as the ground glass. The photographer would compose and make adjustments to the bellows to control the focus. And also you can, with a view camera, which this is a view camera, you can also control the, you're not just moving the lens in relationship to the film plane, you can control the angle of the lens. Let's see how this can tip this way. Let's see. There we go. So you can tip the lens, and you can rotate the lens. And this is used for eliminating distortion or exaggerating distortion. So it's used to control the sort of geometry of the photograph.
So Harvard had one of the earliest cyclotrons in the United States. In 1937, they had their first cyclotron. It was a low energy particle accelerator that was accelerating protons. So the idea was that it was accelerating protons, you shoot the beam, and there was some basic observational science trained to measure what this was. In 1943, the Army made an arrangement with the university to buy the cyclotron for $1 with the promise that they would build a new one after the war. This was taken to Los Alamos, where it was used as part of the Manhattan Project. The second cyclotron was a much higher energy proton device, where a large electromagnet is accelerating a proton beam to almost half the speed of light. And the work was to then shoot this beam out. And then there was a lot of work documenting the Bragg curve, which is when particles are released and go through tissue, there is a predictable curve for the energy and the release of that energy, the Bragg peak, at a certain distance. And so the work of this Harvard cyclotron from 1947 and through the 1950s was measuring this Bragg peak, seeing how much energy a proton would release when it was accelerated to a certain speed. But by the end of the 1950s, the measurements had really, a lot of it had been done. There were more powerful particle accelerators all across the United States. And so there was a real desire to figure out how we could continue to do that. When the cyclotron was designed, it was imagined that there could be a use for protons for nuclear medicine, using this known Bragg peak to attack cancerous tumors inside a body. And so beginning in the early 1950s, working with folks at the medical school, working with Massachusetts General, the cyclotron at Harvard continued its life serving patients, focusing mostly on brain and ocular cancers. And so this control panel was the original control panel for the cyclotron as it existed the day that the cyclotron closed at Harvard in 2002. So from 1951 till 2002, almost 10,000 patients were served by this device that was iteratively enhanced through the addition first of some oscilloscopes, then some early microcomputers, and then a Commodore 64 in the 80s, and this Mac in the 90s that kept it operational for more than 50 years serving this community before a new cyclotron was built at MGH in Boston. Well, in 1839, William Cranch Bond, who was the son of William Bond, a clockmaker here in Boston, who moved from England in the 1870s, came to Harvard as the astronomical observer for the university. And as a clockmaker and someone who's interested in astronomy, he understood crucially the importance of time, both for doing astronomy and for contributing to economic success. So One of his first works that he was doing at the university was standardizing the time from one of the early clocks and making it so it could share that time across the observatory. And by 1851, he had figured out a way with his sons to take the time from this astronomical regulator, which was tied to very precise measurements of how stars were going through the sky, to then send that time through a telegraph wire, which could go to a drum chronograph and could then be further distributed. When he presented this in London at the Crystal Palace exhibition, it revolutionized the way that people all around the world understood how you could take time from a single, very, very accurate device and share it and sell it in order to have standardized time across spaces. That led to the standardization of time, of Harvard time on the East Coast for the railroads, and eventually led to the global patterns and processes that we have for using and sharing time across the world.
So before you had a pocket watch, people had pocket sundials. Some of these are sundials that wouldn't have fit in your pocket, or you'd have to have a large pocket to fit this crucifix sundial. But one of the points that we want you to take away from this is the variety. That instrumentation, things that we use all the time to determine what time of day it is even, come with a huge degree of variety. It was based on what individual consumers wanted, what people were interested in at different times. We've got everything from the memento mori with skull and raining blood, to beautiful ivory diptych sundials, to a little viola up in the back, ivory barrel sundial, a wooden upright sundial with Keebler calculator. It's the one kind of technology that's being manifested in so many different forms in order to respond to consumer need, consumer interest. So among Franklin's purchases, I think, well, he purchased a number of things. He purchased prisms, microscopes, optical instruments, electrical instruments, but I think probably my favorite is this Cometarium here, which demonstrates Newton's laws and Kepler's laws and the transit of comets. And so it's a mechanical device. You can watch how a comet would circle back around. So that's what this one here. And it's beautiful. It's meant to, as a scientific demonstration, mechanical demonstration of, again, how things would move through the cosmos in the same way that the Pope orrery was. These are teaching instruments. Okay, so these are the lenses of the Bruce telescope. And the Bruce telescope is named for Miss Catherine Bruce, who was a wealthy New Yorker, and a woman who put up the funding behind this. And at the time, it was the largest photographic telescope in the world. It was used to observe what became known as variable stars, which become standard lanterns that allow you to measure, among other things, the size of the universe eventually. But this telescope, or the lenses of this telescope, went lots of different places. And that's one of the stories that's quite interesting about it. So it was originally in Cambridge for a couple of years, then it goes to Peru, where it's making telescopic, where they're using it to make observations and to take photographs of big glass plate negatives. And then it goes to South Africa before being shipped back to Harvard. And our curator discovered it a few years ago in a shed. She opened this box and discovered that these are the lenses, not just any old big lenses, but the lenses of the Bruce telescope. And she brought this back out and has put this on display in our collection. It was used by the observations used by Henrietta Leavitt, again, to discover variable stars were discovered using this instrument. And it's a beautiful piece of collecting, a beautiful piece of lens work. A kid is always peering into it, and touching it, but it's a fascinating object.